And the Treasurer has unveiled an $8.6 billion cash splash in this year's pre-election budget, promising cheaper petrol and one-off payments to ease the cost of living. But it all comes at a staggering price. Australia's debt on track to hit $1 trillion.
This is a time to stick to our plan. A plan for a stronger economy and a stronger future. We will deliver.
Let's break down all the commitments that will benefit your hip pocket this morning. The centrepiece of this budget is relief at the bowels of the fuel excise cut in half from midnight to 22 cents. This is estimated to save around $13 on the average tank. For low and middle income earners, there will be extra $420 at tax time, while a one-off payment of $250 will be available next month for eligible pensioners, welfare recipients, veterans, and concession card holders. If you have a small business, there'll be a $120 tax deduction on every $100 spent trading employees. And $5,000 will be paid for new apprentices taking up a trade. The unemployment rate is forecast to fall to 3.75%, the lowest in half a century, while wages could grow by more than 3% next year, which is higher than the forecast rate of inflation. Could. And a win for new parents, the paid parental leave scheme will be changed to allow parents to split 20 weeks leave, while single parents can access the full 20 weeks.
Gee, there's a lot in that, isn't there? Well, we have reporters following the reaction this morning. Let's go first to Nine Federal Politics reporter Eliza Edwards, who's in Canberra. Eliza, there's a fair bit of money being thrown around here. Will this have an impact on the polls?
Well, Ali, that's certainly what it's designed to do. This is a vote-buying budget dressed up as cost-of-living relief. It's full of sweeteners for anyone who drives a car, most Australian workers, also pensioners and families. As you said, Ali, the cost-of-living package alone will see $8.6 billion flow out the door in the next 6 months. Labor's criticism is this budget barely looks beyond the May election and has no plan for the future.
It's a panic, desperate, tapped-out budget from a panic, desperate, tapped-out government. It has nothing to say about the future beyond May. And we've got a plan to grow the economy the right way so the recovery works for everyone.
Ali, it is hard to find any losers in this document, except maybe future taxpayers who will be paying off $1 trillion in debt. But the government's making the calculation they'll tackle budget repair if they manage to win another term. If not, it's a problem for someone else. Broadly speaking, though, the outlook for our economy is pretty rosy. There's low unemployment forecast, inflation getting under control, even optimism about wages growth. But workers have a right to feel sceptical about that, because those predicted pay rises barely ever materialise. Sally.
Thanks for that, Eliza.
Lara Vella joins us now from Northmead in Sydney's West. Lara, how are people reacting to the budget this morning?
Well, Carl, we know right now that the cost of petrol alongside the rising cost of groceries is a huge pressure on so many Australians right across the country. And while in general these cash payments, tax relief and also the temporary halving of the fuel excise will be welcomed, some key industry groups, particularly in the welfare and the aged care sector, have said that these incentives will do nothing in the long term to help with the rising cost of living pressures and accused the Treasurer of delivering a spend-a-thon budget. Here was some reaction from Canberra last night.
We needed permanent solutions. We got temporary fixes.
This budget has delivered some relief, but not some reform.
Now, Carl, as for drivers, it is unlikely that they'll feel this relief at the bowser for at least the next 2 weeks, but because, of course, these petrol retailers will still have to go through their current supply. But as for those retailers who are advertising these lower prices and failed to do so, be warned, the ACCC is now on the lookout, and if you don't deliver on those promises, these petrol retailers could face fines of up to $10 million. Carl?
Lara, thank you.
Outgoing Liberal Senator Concetta Fierravanti-Wells has launched an attack on Scott Morrison, calling him a bully. In a speech to the Senate last night, she accused both the Prime Minister and Immigration Minister Alex Hawke of ruining the Liberal Party.
By now, you might be getting the picture that Morrison is not interested in the rules-based order. It is his way or the highway, an autocrat, a bully who has no moral compass. In my public life, I have met ruthless people. Morrison tops the list.
Wow.
She didn't miss, did she? The senator is leaving politics after being placed in an unwinnable position on the party's Senate ticket. And Treasurer Josh Frydenberg will be live on today just after 7am this morning, while the Prime Minister will be joining us live after 7.30.
A severe weather system is right now smashing parts of northern New South Wales as residents in southeast Queensland begin the clean-up. We have reporters in both states. First, Mia Glover in Mullumbah, in New South Wales. Mia, there's been a relief for residents in Lismore this morning.
Well, yeah, they thought so for the last couple of hours, Carl, but just within the last 30 minutes or so, they're again in the firing line. This is really concerning for them. The New South Wales SES has just issued an evacuation order for the Lismore CBD and surrounding areas because they've just had so much rain within the last couple of hours or so. There is a big concern this morning that the Wilson's River will hit the flood levee later this morning. So they're telling people to leave the CBD because they're really concerned about roads in and out being inundated and then people there being trapped. But I tell you what, it has been another sleepless night for the people of the Northern Rivers. In Ballina, they copped about 100 millimetres of rain in the space of an hour. Just extraordinary rainfall totals there. We've seen a house flow down the Wilson's River and also so many landslips and slides on roads around the region. We are waking up in South Mullumbah this morning. As you can see behind me, there is still some floodwaters right around the area and so many roads are inundated as well. Here at this stage, there's no evacuation order, but there is an evacuation warning. So people are being put on notice to prepare to evacuate. But the system right now, Carl, is starting to move south to the mid-north coast.
Mia, thank you.
Let's go now to Jessica Millwood on the Gold Coast. And Jess, the clean-up is underway.
Good morning, Ali. It is. Thankfully, the rain has finally eased off on the Gold Coast after days of being torrential. Tullabudra was the worst hit, receiving 358 millimetres in just a day and a half. It meant parks have gone underwater, roads have been cut off and we've seen landslips, and many businesses have been forced to sandbag and protect their properties for the second time in 1 month. There is, the floodwaters are now receding this morning, but there is a strong weather warning in place for the Gold Coast beaches. There has been a very bad erosion on our beaches. Here at the Oxenford Weir, you can see just how much water is flowing through the catchments. That is why the Weather Bureau is warning that we could see river rises if we get any more torrential rain. West to Dalby, the people there are also cleaning up after the river peaked at a major flood level, but below what was predicted. The forecast for today, more rain, but thankfully nothing like what we have seen, 20 millimetres on the cards for the Gold Coast. Ali?
OK, thanks for that, Jess. And beachside communities across Sydney are on alert as a strong weather system moves south. The city has recorded 84 mils of rain in nearly 2 days, with Warragamba Dam spilling 19 gigalitres a day.
Well, the King of Spin will be farewelled at the MCG tonight with Shane Warne's family, friends and fans in attendance in force. Today, Melbourne reporter Isabella Stashkowski is at the G with us today. Isa, good morning to you. Warne's children will deliver speeches. It'll be powerful.
Carl, good morning. Most certainly will. The two-hour-long service will be opened with those speeches from family. Incredibly emotional, but it will also be a big celebration of Shane Warne's life, both as the cricket legend and, of course, as the larrikin. A bevy of international stars are going to be taking part, the likes of Robbie Williams, Elton John and Ed Sheeran. Yesterday, those preparations inside the MCG were kept pretty secret, but we have now been given a bit of a look inside, and those stands later today will be filled with more than 51,000 people, as hundreds of millions are expected to watch on from overseas, countries like India, Pakistan, Bangladesh and the UK. Shane Warne's son Jackson has also spoken about the magnitude of all of this and how he feels about this state memorial being held here at the MCG.
I think for a lot of us, especially our family, it's a great honour to have it at the MCG. He's done a lot of great things here. It's where he got his 700th wicket. He's made a lot of Victorians, Melburnians and Australians proud here on the very ground we're standing on. And he's got a statue at the front, and to have a grandstand named after him now is just unbelievable.
Carl, gates will open from 5:30 this afternoon. Anyone in attendance is being asked to be seated by 6:45 and come via public transport. They're also being requested to wear their cricket gear in memory of the Spin King.
I reckon that is such a great gesture.
I watched
Tony Jones on the news last night, National 9 News locally, and he was dusting off his whites. And he's coming down here a little bit later on, so I can't wait to see TJ in his tight
bringing his whites with him. I mean, you're going to hang around for that.
That's going to be huge. And look, a cavalcade of stars coming down, as well as TJ a little bit later on. It's going to be special.
That's it. All right, let's head back to the studio now, and Jane has the rest of the day's news. Morning, Jane.
Morning, Ali and Carlin. Good morning to you at home. There is a major development in the Ukraine crisis this morning. Russia has announced it will scale back military combat in two key areas of Ukraine as peace talks resume. Let's go live now to our Europe correspondent, Kari-Anne Greenbank in Lviv. And Kari, this is the most meaningful progress yet.
Well, Jane, it is. It's the biggest step towards peace we've seen so far, but it comes with a fair amount of scepticism. Russia has said it will dramatically reduce its military activity around the capital, Kyiv, and also the northern city of Chernihiv. The US, the UK and Ukraine are all reporting signs of de-escalation, with footage emerging of Russian tanks moving away from the capital. But the US President and Secretary of State both remain unconvinced. They're both essentially saying they will believe it when they see it. US officials, though, are saying that this could mark a major change in Russian strategy, essentially admitting it's failed to capture the capital and now trying to solidify its gains in the east and south of the country. Certainly in the south of the country, we have seen more bombardment today. The city of Mykolaiv was hit by new airstrikes. In fact, they blew a large hole in the middle of a city administration building, and that blast killed at least 12 people. So peace, it's tentative at best. The talks continue today, and Jane, they also continue tomorrow.
Kari-Anne, thank you. Meanwhile, Australia will impose sanctions on 39 Russians linked to the death of Ukrainian-born Russian lawyer Sergei Magnitsky. Mr. Magnitsky uncovered corruption by tax and law officials in Russia. He died in custody in 2009 after he was refused medical treatment. Back home now, and some relief for parents in WA heading into term two of the school year. The state's education minister has released a COVID blueprint for schools after they return from the April holiday break. Parents will be allowed back onto school grounds and some school events will be able to resume. Masks will remain mandatory in classrooms for students in year three and above. Let's have a look at the markets now on Wall Street. The Dow is up and the S&P 500 is also faring well. At home, the All Ords also closed up yesterday. In London, the FTSE ended in the green too. Commodities and gold is at $1,900 an ounce. Oil is at $112 a barrel. A year on from his death, the life of Prince Philip has been celebrated at a memorial service at Westminster Abbey. We'll go live now to our Europe correspondent, Brett McLeod. And Brett, after much speculation, the Queen was able to attend.
She's had COVID, she's had difficulty walking, but after 6 months since her last public appearance, we did get to see the Queen today. And we also knew that her son, Prince Andrew, would be going. What we didn't expect is that he would be accompanying her down the aisle.
A queen known for her privacy, mourning in public. It was very much a family affair. Her Majesty arrived on the arm of Prince Andrew in his first public appearance since settling his sexual assault case. Prince William and Kate, accompanied by George and Charlotte, who couldn't attend their great-grandfather's funeral due to COVID restrictions. Today, a different scene, the Abbey full and brimming with life. The Queen no longer sitting alone. The Duke of Edinburgh remembered for his duty and his unique way with people.
There's no doubt that he had a delightfully engaging and often self-deprecating sense of humour.
The tributes overwhelming for some, as the royal family said a final farewell to a remarkable man.
Moreover, nobody would ever doubt his loyalty and deep devotion to our Queen and to their family.
1,800 people inside Westminster Abbey, but all eyes are on the woman in green, appropriately Duke of Edinburgh Green, the Queen. Jane?
It wasn't it great to see her out and about, Brett? Thank you. Well, let's get your first check of the weather now with Tim, who's on the Gold Coast this morning. Morning, Timmy.
Good morning to you, Jane. Nice to have you with us. Yeah, a little soggy here on the Gold Coast, as we heard from Jess not long ago, but it is starting to dry out today. Still a few scattered showers here around southeast Queensland through until about lunchtime today when it clears off. It was all thanks to a deepening low, which is off the coast, but it's combined with a trough that is closer to the coast, and that is generating all of that cloud and those showers and storms that we are seeing. Some of the rainfall figures that we've seen as that rain bomb has moved down the coast into northern New South Wales and the mid-north coast of New South Wales, I can tell you in the last 24 hours, we have seen around 239 millimetres of rain falling at Ballina, around 230 at Evans Head, Cape Byron a little less, 130 millimetres of rain, and Coffs Harbour picking up 149 mils as well. So there is still a lot of rain to come as that system does continue to move south, but it is petering out, which is some good news. We'll keep an eye on how that is tracking for you throughout the day. Weather-wise, though, with our temperatures, let's start with our fly-around forecast, as we always do at this time of the morning. Queensland looking fine and lovely up top, mostly sunny for Cairns today, a top of 33 degrees. Townsville, Mackay, the Whitsunday region, all looking fine and sunny. Inland looking pretty good as well, Mount Isa and Longreach. We'll start to see the effects of those clouds, though, around the Capricornia region. Rockhampton today, cloudy, a top of 32 degrees, partly cloudy for Gladstone and also for Bundaberg. A possible early shower clearing off around the Sunshine Coast and a few scattered showers, as I mentioned, here on the Gold Coast. For New South Wales, good morning to you. Some showers around for Grafton. We'll see that rain continue throughout the Northern Rivers region as well. Cloudy for Tamworth today. Inland, Broken Hill, sunny in 24 for you. The Riverina today, a few showers around for Gosford. The Riverina, though, mostly sunny for Wagga Wagga and for Albury. A shower or two for Canberra and a top of 19 degrees. Let's take a look at Victoria and Tasmania for you right now. Fine and sunny for both Mildura and for Bendigo, where we were yesterday. It was beautiful there. A few showers, though, for Sale, for Warrnambool and also for Ballarat today. And for Tassie, partly cloudy for Launceston, a shower or two for Swansea. Strawn, some morning showers heading for a high of 17 degrees. To South Australia, a shower or two clearing for Mount Gambier, 20 degrees. Heading for tops in the mid-20s for Port Lincoln, Ceduna and Coober Pedy, with a few clouds around there. For Western Australia today, a little cloudy around the southwest. Shower or two for Kalgoorlie and Geraldton. Also possible showers for Port Hedland and for Broome. Finally, the Northern Territory today, partly cloudy for Darwin, Alice Springs for you. Mostly sunny and a high of 33 degrees. Also a hazardous surf warning in place here on the Gold Coast, guys. We'll keep an eye on conditions, but right now let's head back to Carl and Ali in Melbourne. Guys, good morning.
Good stuff there this morning, Tim.